look at the students' movement today, the students of Nigeria are working on a tight thread. There are no scholarships for young people to grow, and it's the students' unionism that you use in growing up leaders, in replicating leaders, or where you have the tutelage and mentorship for leadership. But we are now having difficult times because there is lack of investment in the human capital that which prepares the country for tomorrow, which prepares your working capital or your human capital for your economy. You don't do anybody a favor when you give them scholarships. You are building the human capacity for your economy. And it's unfortunate that what we are having today is that the lot of the political class, we are having them, everybody sending their children abroad, they have enough money, they are well paid, and now we are keeping people in school in other countries because the amount of money that we are paying for schools, for student, for fees abroad is enough to build so many. And that is to say that the kind of schools that we have, the public schools, many of the people in government today, they graduated from public schools. We are having people in Nigeria today that are not earning salaries, you know, that have been retired for the past 2 years or how many years without pension. In many governments today, and many salaries are not being paid, and those governors are comfortable to walk around, have their bulletproof vehicles, and move around and say it's okay. If you can imagine somebody not earning salaries, and that person is going to bed every night, you know there is an engine room for the conflicts that, some of the conflicts that we're having in Nigeria. And I want the government to know that we are not an enemy. We are doing our job. But don't give us too much job because you are not being responsive. It is important to provide inclusive governance to ensure that both the young people, women are brought on board. The President Muhammadu Buhari promised 40% representation for women. And 2 years down the line, for the half term, he has not found women. We will struggle together, but in the interest of Nigeria. I want to connect with all of you this morning. We walk the talk. I stand upright for Nigeria. Are you standing upright for Nigeria where you are?
Those of us in the Nigeria Police Force do not in any way see members of the civil society organizations as adversaries. We rather see you as partners and as those who both nature and our society has compelled us and made it necessary for us to work with. We want to see civil society organizations that can identify problems, work with us to deal with the problems, identify our areas of shortfalls, and work with us to find affirmative actions to deal with them. That is not to say the government have to abdicate its responsibility. Absolutely no. We are not abdicating our responsibility. We are not shifting everything to you. But we are saying, let's work together.
As a civil society organization, we expect that groups and organizations should support security agencies to overcome challenges. In Borno State, in the northeast and northwest, there are discoveries of some secret, civil society groups that are aiding and abetting terrorism in ways unexpected of such groups. There are civil society groups that are acquiring arms for insurgents, and that shouldn't be. We expect that civil society groups, either at individual level or at group level, should connect, should collaborate, should partner with security agencies and critical stakeholders also in government to exchange information and seek solutions to problems. It is the duty of civil society, and indeed in collaboration with security agencies and other educators, to begin to educate the society appropriately to understand that fake news, hate speech, misinformation, disinformation play ugly roles in the unity of nations and indeed mobilizing national loyalty and patriotism.
There's been a lot of misconception, myth about civil society organization. Some see some governmental institution see civil society as adversary, as anti-government, because they feel that there is nothing civil society do or say that is not against government. The essence was to let governmental institutions, and of course, even us as civil society organizations, to rethink about the model, the strategy, and the way we interrogate and engage in our own intervention. And we'll be able to do that. People have seen in this conference that civil society truly contribute to development of this country, whether it's in democratic strengthening, whether it's in humanitarian sector, whether it's in service delivery, whether it's in advocacy. For example, the Police Act 2020, the civil society was very instrumental to that new bill, and which was signed by President Muhammadu Buhari. In fact, a lot, even the Human Rights Commission, the setting up of the Human Rights Commission was at the effort of the struggle or the advocacy by civil society organization. The improvement in our electoral architecture, the Electoral Act, for example, is a product of civil society advocacy and engagement. That the civil society truly and truly contribute to the development of Nigeria. However, people talk about the bad eggs. Well, we needed to interrogate, what do you mean when you say civil society, the bad eggs? Someone gets opportunity to get registered and begin to run civil society work and calls himself civil society, or call a press conference and pay people to peddle those information, doesn't really classify that individual as a comrade or a senior activist or whatever it is. We must get to the point that before we call people civil society actors or leaders, we must really know what they've done before, because sincerely, for every original, there is a fake. And we cannot weigh that out, but regulating the sector and making it general, we also be impeding on the real, what we call the original civil society organization. Regulation is not in the best interest of the development that civil society do engage in.